Blackstone Audio presents The Three Weissmanns of Westport by Cathleen Schine. To the indelible memory of Bertha Aaronworth, the fruit does not fall far from the tree. Chapter 1. When Joseph Weissman divorced his wife, he was 78 years old and she was 75. He announced his decision in the kitchen of their apartment on the 10th floor of a large, graceful Central Park West building built at the turn of the last century, the original white tiles of the kitchen still gleaming on the walls around them. Joseph, known as Joe to his colleagues at work, but always called Joseph by his wife, said the words, "irreconcilable differences," and saw real confusion in his wife's eyes. "Irreconcilable differences," she said. "Of course there are irreconcilable differences. What on earth does that have to do with divorce?" In Joe's case, it had very little to do with divorce. In Joe's case, as is so often the case, the reason for the divorce was a woman. But a woman was not, unsurprisingly, the reason he gave his wife. "Irreconcilable differences?" Betty was surprised. They had been married for 48 years. She was used to Joseph, and she was sure Joseph was used to her. But he would not be dissuaded. Their history was history to him. Joseph had once been a handsome man. Even now he was straight, unstooped. His bald head was somehow distinguished rather than lacking. As if men, important men, aspired to a smooth, shining pate. His nose was narrow and protruded importantly. His eyes were also narrow, and, as he aged, increasingly protected by folds of skin, as if they were secrets. Women liked him. Betty had certainly liked him once. He was quiet and unobtrusive, requiring only a large breakfast before he went to work, a large glass of scotch when he arrived home, and a small light dinner at 7:30 sharp. Over the years, Betty began to forget that she liked Joseph. The large breakfast seemed grotesque, the drink obsessive, the light supper an affectation. This happened in their third decade together and lasted until their fourth. Then, Betty noticed, Joseph's routines somehow began to take on a comforting rhythm, like the heartbeat of a mother to a newborn baby. Betty was once again content, in love even. They traveled to Tuscany and stood in the Chianti Hills watching the swallows and the swift clouds of slate-gray rain approaching. They took a boat through the fjords of Norway and another through the Galapagos Islands. They took a train through India from one palace to the next, imagining the vanished Raj and eating fragrant, delicate curries. They did all these things together, and then all these things stopped. "Irreconcilable differences," Joe said. "Oh, Joseph, what does that have to do with divorce?"
"I want to be generous," Joe said.
Generous, she thought. It was as if she were the maid and she was being fired. Would he offer her 2 months' salary? "You cannot be generous with what is mine," she said. And the divorce, like horses in a muddy race, their sides frothing, was off and running. The name of Joe's irreconcilable difference was Felicity, although Betty referred to her, pretending she could not remember the correct name, sometimes as Pleurisy, more often as Duplicity. But that was later, when Betty had surrendered the apartment on Central Park West. During the negotiations leading up to that move, Betty and her daughters were left to speculate, to surmise, and to suspect the existence of a Felicity, to whom they had never been formally introduced.
"I will be generous to my wife," Joe told Felicity. "After all, I did spend almost 50 years of my life with the woman."
When he said the words, "my wife," it made Felicity glare at him. But he didn't notice. For when he said the word 50...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.